In Australia, we have to keep very strict records of you know, plasmids and vectors and things that we use in biomedical research. And they can be used in certain laboratories that have got the appropriate containment levels and not in others. And they have to be transported between laboratories in an appropriate way. You just can't stick them in your pocket and walk down the corridor. They often have to be double wrapped in sealed containers. And the government agencies that look after these things can come in and do inspections. Now, generally, they're very nice to us. They tell us when they're going to come in and inspect. And so we all run around and get everything looking highly polished and tidy and wonderful. But they can come in and make unannounced inspections. And in Australia, if you get caught out, the university gets a big fine. They can shut down research. There are very serious consequences. They may not be as severe in Malaysia, but they still can be important. It's also about public perception. We don't want our institution in the papers for the wrong reason. We want to see UTAR in the papers because we've done fabulous research in our area of research, not because a student was found or a supervisor was found to be doing something wrong and we've had to shut down that whole line of research. Sometimes there are unwritten rules or conventions which students don't know. And these are things that they do need to understand. Sometimes a student does things that probably cross over between ethics and the social context. So there are things that people are very focused on these days around sexual harassment, discrimination, sexism, ageism, people have to be careful about what they say and do in certain situations. And students need to be thinking about some of the things they say, maybe in jest, to another student or another staff member. I don't know what it's like in Malaysia, but in Australia, sexual harassment is defined as anything that makes the person that you say something to uncomfortable. You might have only meant it as a joke and nothing else, but if I'm the recipient and I feel very uncomfortable, whoever said it can potentially be in trouble if they make a complaint. So, students and staff need to be very aware of the personal dynamic between themselves, their students, other staff, and other students. And we had the case study yesterday of one student coming to tell us that there was one of the other students and an international student having a clash of personality. And that could be anything to do with their cultural background, their religion, politics. It's always better, I think, if the students just stick to discussing their science. It's hard to get into trouble that way. But I once had to referee an argument between two students, not in my department, who started discussing a movie that they both went to see independently. And they both had completely different ideas, and then it got into a shouting match about some of the behaviour of the characters in the movie. And then, you think, this is trivial, but it got to the stage where they were shouting at each other, calling each other unpleasant things, disrupting the whole of that. People down the corridor could hear them, wondered what was going on. Just inappropriate behaviour. And so that kind of social context or inappropriate behaviour, we have to stop them. And more often than not in these kind of situations, we have to call the students in and say that this is just not inappropriate. There's no other way to deal with it. And sometimes you have to explain, perhaps to international students, you know, that this might happen in your country, but it can't happen here, because there are laws against this. Sometimes, again, just depending on the situation, a mediator might be the best person. Sometimes, if the student ignores the advice and guidance, we have to go back to our old friend, higher authority. So we've had situations in particular where, I think I mentioned them yesterday, where we had male candidates, more mature age male candidates from the Middle East, who were being given advice and guidance by female supervisors. They wouldn't accept the advice, A, because the female staff member was female and younger than them. We have to call on a male higher authority figure to back up the female's arguments. What they're saying is absolutely correct. You cannot do this, or this is not appropriate behaviour. We've touched on things about shortcomings in terms of equipment or failure. You know, when things break down or stop working, we've got to be proactive. Move to an alternative technical. Maybe there's some other way that we can do it. Go somewhere else, use equipment or facilities elsewhere in our institution or at another institution, trying to get around this problem as quickly as possible. Surprisingly, it seems the more sophisticated the equipment becomes and the more we spend to buy that equipment, the longer it seems to take to get the highly qualified technician out to fix it. Because often they have to come from overseas. Because the companies, it's probably the same in Malaysia as in Australia, we don't spend enough money in the area of that equipment for them to keep highly trained technical staff resident in Australia or perhaps in Malaysia, so they have to come from Europe or America, and then we have to wait in the queue until they come. And so quite considerable time can be lost to get repairs done. So this is why we've got to be proactive and move to alternatives or find an equivalent piece of equipment somewhere else. Sometimes the shortcoming has been inadequacy in terms of the project plan. We hadn't thought far enough ahead. Or things change radically in fields of research sometimes. A new finding breaks open something, or a new technology breaks open a new pathway or direction that we want to take. So the quickest way to deal with that is to use equipment or facilities that might be somewhere else, that somebody else has already got in place. Sometimes we might have to reevaluate the project goals and to deal with what can be really feasible. Feasible in terms of the resources that are available to us. So, what about external problems? These are the things kind of outside our day-to-day working relationship with the students, about equipment, about their relationships with other people in the research group or the lab or who they're working with. So these are just a few examples. It's all about life happening again. Their health, their parents' health, their partner's health, their child's health, their grandmother's health, their next door neighbour's health, their friend's health, something about childcare. Relationships. Divorce. Break up with a girlfriend or boyfriend. I found a new boyfriend or a girlfriend and put all their energy into that. Financial and work. So, most everybody in the room has been a student sometime. You know what kind of stipend you had as a master's or a PhD student. It's not very much. You know possibly what a struggle it was financially to survive on that, even if you had or did have a partner who works and brought in some other income into the relationship, it's still a struggle. So if you're doing the research part-time while trying to do a job, and your employer comes to you and says, I need you to work more hours, that's going to impinge on your part-time research. We can discuss all these things with our students, and we can be empathetic, and we can help steer students to places in the university that can give advice and give assistance. But we are not marriage guidance counsellors. We are not financial counsellors. We're not babysitters. We cannot do the childcare. Although I've done it once. While one of my students had to rush off to a critical appointment and just didn't have anybody to look after their 3-year-old daughter, so I did it for half an hour. She played in my office with the magnetic sticker things on my filing cabinet. That kept her amused for half an hour. But I swore never again. And I only did it because it was an emergency thing. But see, we're not there to do those kinds of things. But if there are resources in the university that we can help point students to, is there a university childcare center? Some many institutions there are. So maybe for whatever reason the student doesn't know about that, we can point them to. So this is all about knowing what assistance is available that we can direct students to. Sometimes with these things they almost seem insurmountable for the student. They're just so pressing, so demanding of the student's time. There's really no way that they're going to be able to do research and deal with this critical issue that's happening outside their life as a research student. And so here, leave of absence, I think, really is something that needs to be discussed. Go away for a trimester, semester, half a year, a full year. Get over all those issues, get them sorted out, then come back to research. If your student takes leave of absence, don't let them disappear completely. Maintain at least some contact, even if it's only by email. If they choose not to answer you, okay, you can't do any more. I mean, we cannot be too intrusive, but at least if you send them an email, you know, after a couple of months, haven't seen you and heard from you, hope everything's going well, let me know if there's anything you want to talk about. You're due to come back to research in 3 months' time. We should meet a couple of weeks ahead of that and talk about the project and just check on where things are at and what we might need to do to get you back into the swing of research again. That's what we want to do rather than, they've taken a leave of absence for 6 months. The 6-month anniversary comes and you suddenly think, where's my student? I was expecting them back for that, but did you do anything really about expecting them back? Sure, a lot of the onus is on them, but we want, I think by maintaining at least some minimal contact or giving them that opportunity, that helps to make sure that they don't disappear completely. Now, in the end, it might be their decision that whatever this event is that's happening is just too much, they can't possibly go on with research, so we have to be prepared for that. But in the vast majority of cases, in my experience, this kind of break does usually give students the opportunity and the